So my name is Zac Fitz-Walter. Today I'm going to be talking about creating memorable apps. So this is me here. I'm an associate lecturer from QUT up in Queensland, sunny Brisbane. And I teach there a range of different subjects, from mobile app development to game design. And the one I'm teaching at the moment is gamification design. And this was an area that I was interested in because I also did my PhD in the area, so looking at gamification design and how we can improve the experience of mobile apps by adding game elements to them. Now, we're not going to be talking about that in detail today. We're going to be taking a more general approach to looking at the user experience of mobile apps which we develop. I also, in my spare time, run a company with Jimmy T, who's somewhere in the audience here. There he is, there. Eat More Pixels, where we create a number of apps for clients. And we also, in our spare time, make apps for ourselves when we get the chance. But as you can imagine, sometimes that spare time can be hard to find. Right, okay. So today, this is kind of from one of the lectures that I present in the gamification subject. And it's looking at the user experience of applications and looking in particular beyond just making usable apps and how we can make apps which will hopefully get reviews a little bit like this. So this is these are reviews from an app, one of my favorite apps, not one that I developed, but one of my favorite ones out there. And I'm just going to show you some of the titles of the reviews that people have submitted. Oh, wait, no, first of all, that's my Twitter handler. So just in case you wanted to follow me on Twitter, that's or tweet to me, you can get me there. Okay, so here are some of the words. So, love. That's nice, isn't it? So someone who said love in one of the reviews for this app. I am in love. It changed my life. Fast, simple magic. Simple, elegant, and useful. Unreal! Exclamation mark. Perfect. Wow, and best app ever. Now, that's I'd be chuffed if I got reviews like that for my app. What kind of app do you think that was for? Flappy Birds. It was not for Flappy Birds. Yeah. Crossy Road. It was not for Crossy Road either. What kind of app? It was actually for a to-do list app. Interesting, right? So, you know, a couple of game suggestions there, but it's actually for this app in particular, which is called Clear. It was released in 2012. And it's interesting, this app, you know, released after probably to-do list apps. You think to-do list apps have been done to death, but nonetheless released and became quite popular. And what's interesting was they created a very memorable experience for their users. And we'll be talking a little bit about this app in particular today and looking at how it went about doing that, as well as discussing other examples of apps which have created memorable experiences. So three things we're going to be talking about today. The first is that when you're designing your applications, good usability is a minimum to consider. The second thing we're going to be discussing is then you can look at user experience goals in order to create a better user experience for your users. And finally, we'll finish up with some methods, tools, and tips to help you get started kind of in this area. Okay, so the first thing I want you to take away today from this presentation is that good usability is a minimum when you're designing and developing your applications. So, who's heard of usability? I'm sure, hopefully, yes, excellent, that's good. So, when we talk about usability, the definition for it is that it is an attribute that assesses how easy user interfaces are to use. And basically, when you're designing or developing a piece of software these days, good usability is a necessary condition for survival out on the App Store. If your app is difficult to use, users are likely going to leave. If your app is unclear in terms of what it offers users, users are likely going to leave as well. And if it's easy to get lost, users will also likely leave. Good usability shouldn't be invisible to the... good usability should be invisible to the user. So, you know, they shouldn't notice that your app has good usability. It's when it has bad usability is when it becomes a problem. If you don't know this meme, it's reflective of that. So when you have bad usability, users will notice it. They will, you know, realize that problems exist with the design, and it will make them frustrated beyond anything. And they may just decide to give up on your app and move to another alternative because there are many, many other alternative apps out there. Okay, so what should you be aiming to achieve when it comes to creating a usable experience for your users? Well, if we're talking about usability, there's some goals that we can aim towards trying to achieve when we develop our apps. So that is making an app that is efficient to use, effective to use, safe to use, have good utility, easy to learn, and easy to remember. Easy to remember how to use. So let's go through these in a little bit of detail just quickly. So your app should be easy to learn. So what we mean by this is that it should be easy for users, the first time they encounter your application, to know how to use your application or to learn quickly how to use your application. So a great example is if you give someone something like this that's remote, it might be quite difficult for someone to learn how to use it compared to, say, another remote out there which is a little bit easier. If we talk about learnability, the features of your app should be clear. It should be obvious for users how to use your app. If users skip your introduction, which they will, and they often don't read text as well, or introductory text, will they still know how to use the application? Your application should also be efficient to use. And what we mean by this is that once users have learned the design of your application, how quickly can they perform tasks? Now, here's a parking meter near me, and I'm going to put it out there and say this is probably one of the most inefficient designs I've ever seen. So, you know, in terms of the procedure of steps that you have to take, it's all over the place, and just knowing what to do is really, it can be really difficult, and it's quite inefficient to use. So you need to be asking yourself, is your app efficient to use? Does your app support mastery and flow? So, you know, if we have to do something quickly to it, can it be easy to make changes and efficient to do things to your app? So, for example, if I wanted to bold some text in the Notes app, I have to go about selecting it. Once I've done that, dragging it down, then move across bold. And it's probably not the most efficient way in which to write, say, a PhD thesis, for example. Your app should be easy to remember how to use as well. So when users return to the design after a period of not using it, how easy can they re-establish proficiency? And again, we'll use this remote as an example. So with a TV remote, it can be quite difficult. And I've seen people attempt to make it easier, especially for older users as well, just to make sure that they can remember how to use it. Your app should be safe to use as well. So what we mean by this is, how many errors do the users make? How severe are these errors, and how easily can they recover from these errors? And if errors do occur, what ramifications are there? So, you know, for example, deleting an email or a text by accident. If we were to accidentally swipe too far across when deleting an email, what effect will that have on our users? I don't think you can shake to undo it anymore, is that right? Was that ever a thing in mail? Or am I just walking around shaking it? Looking ridiculous. Maybe. I think it's just undoing in the Note app. Anyway, your app should be effective to use, which is concerned primarily with how quickly a task can be completed. When efficiency is concerned with how quickly a task can be completed, effectiveness considers how well the work is done. So how completely and accurately is the task that you offer with your app completed or the user goals reached? And finally, probably one of the most important usability goals is that your application should have good utility. And what we mean by this is that does it do what the users need it to do? Is your app addressing a particular problem that the user has? And does it provide functionality that is going to help the user complete their desired task? So, basically, as app developers, we should all be striving towards creating something which is useful for our users. And when is something useful? Well, when it provides something that the users need, so that's in terms of a utility, and when it provides it in a way which is easy to use, and that is usability. So usefulness can be measured by the utility that an app provides and the usability of the app itself. Now, there are many useful methods. We won't go into great detail that can help you create good usable apps. So for example, adopting a user-centered design process is one way. And what we mean by this is you need to understand who your users are, and you need to design for what they want in an application. So you should always be designing for your users in mind. And you can fall quite easily into the trap that you as a developer yourself are the users, when in actual fact, it's most likely not going to be the case. And so one of the most important things you can do with the apps that you create is test it with your users as well. So that means getting it out, your app, into the hands of people who are actually going to be using your app and testing it with them. Iterative design is a great process to undertake as well. And what we mean by this is that you create prototypes quite early on in the process. So these could be paper prototypes, for example. They could be basic interactive prototypes. We saw a great presentation yesterday by Steph looking at creating prototypes in Keynote. And this is a great way to get these kind of ideas of your app out to your users quickly and to get feedback. Undertake usability testing. And Nick Witterson, talked about this yesterday in great detail in his presentation on user testing and what they do in Canva. And user testing is incredibly important. So you need to get a hold of some representative users. You need to ask users to perform representative tasks with the design. So that is tasks that they're actually going to be or should be doing with the design itself. And you need to observe what the users do, where they succeed, and where they have difficulties with the user interface itself. One of the most difficult things when it comes to user testing, I find, is giving your application to a user and sitting there and just watching them use it. Because at certain times, you just kind of want to jump in. You're like, you just need to click this thing to go to... And that's the whole point of user testing, is that you want to try and get as much feedback, and you don't want to interrupt them so you can see where they're having problems with the interface. Right, some useful tools when it comes to usability design. So Apple has a general guidelines when it comes to designing your apps, and they have a great website on UI design do's and don'ts, which can be found at this web address, where they talk about, for example, formatting content in your apps and what is kind of best practices for things like that. If you haven't read the Human Interface Guidelines, I suggest you highly do, because this is one of the most important set of guidelines when it comes to creating apps for the App Store. So they can be found there at that URL. Although, take some of them with a grain of salt, because they may not be the most effective at times. For example, embracing borderless buttons, which I find to be maybe sometimes not the best way to do certain things. How do I hide this? System off. This is a good practice in usability. Ah, thank you. Excellent. Okay, cool. If you jump onto this website, 10 Usability Heuristics for UI Design, this is from the Nielsen and Norman group. These are kind of like the grandfathers of usability when it comes to it. So they provide usability heuristics for good interface design. These are great just to kind of run through with your application and make sure that you are, addressing the heuristics that they provide there. In terms of prototyping, we've used Envision before. It's great, so you can kind of mock up your apps. You can get them out on devices and make them interactive so people can start playing around with them. And also, we talked about Keynote early in Steph's presentation yesterday. User testing, Nick went into this in great detail, so you can refer to his presentation yesterday. But you can actually jump online and you can get people, you can kind of get user testers remotely as well, which is great. So, if you can't find people around you who are representative of your users for your application, you can kind of outsource this using services such as user testing. We also, previously have looked at integrating tools into our apps as well to capture things like what people or where people are tapping. And Lookback is a great example of one of these tools which does that. So what this does is this will record user sessions with apps. So it will record taps with apps. And it will also record their face with the camera as well. So you can see the way in which they're reacting when they're using your apps. And finally, one of my favorite websites, User Onboarding. And this is an excellent resource for looking at how people are first introduced to apps out there and some of the problems that they may encounter when they first start using apps. And there's a great teardown on this website of the Apple Music app as well, which I highly encourage you to check out. Okay, so moving on. Is good usability enough these days when it comes to developing apps? I'm going to put it out there and I'm going to say no. So the reason for this is that, as I said before, there are so many apps out there on the App Store. If we have a look at some of the more recent stats, so, on the Apple App Store, there are over 1.5 million apps out there, a few more on the Google Play Store. And so it can be really difficult standing out. If you're developing an app, you want people to see your app, or you want people to download and use your app, you're going to need to do probably one of two things. The first thing is either provide some functionality which doesn't already exist out there on the App Store. So that is creating, an app which provides people with something new that they haven't done before. Or you can look at creating a better experience for existing apps that currently exist. You could also do both as well, which would be great. Okay, so let's move on to the next section, creating a better experience, because this is what I want to focus on. So I want to focus on how we can look at user experience and design for this. Right, I want to imagine that you're creating a to-do list app. So you've decided, yes, our next app project will be a to-do list app. We're going to go out, we're going to make a to-do list app, we'll publish it, and make millions. So the first thing that we would probably do is that we would, after maybe identifying our users and talking to them, we would probably decide on the feature list for our to-do list app. So this is the functionality that users require. Maybe we then design it, or we jump online and we do a quick search for other to-do list apps out there just to do a quick competitor analysis, maybe. And as soon as we jump on the store, we're like, oh, hang on a second. There's quite a lot of other to-do list apps out there. Hundreds, in fact. So if you do a search for to-do list apps, you'll find many, many others out there. It seems to be the staple in terms of creating maybe one of the first apps. So we could give up and we could move on, or we could look at how we could create a to-do list app that's a little bit different, and maybe instead focus on the experience first. So this is what if, you know, this is looking at what if we took a different approach to creating a to-do list app. So rather than think about the features first, what if we then instead focused on the user's experience? And you could end up something that's a little bit different to all other apps out there. Maybe something a little bit like this. So I'm going to show you this Clear app and give you, who's used Clear app before? Ah, good. So most of you have used it. So you probably, for those of you who haven't, here's a quick video which provides an overview of how it works. Okay, so that's the Clear app, which is fun. It's just fun watching that video. They make great use of things like gestures and sound, etc.
It really makes all those sounds.
It does make all of those sounds, yeah. Yeah, it does. what's the difference? Well, most likely there's more of a focus on the experience. So that is looking at designing with experience in mind first. And there's this great tool called the User Experience Hierarchy of Needs, and this is by Steven Anderson from his book Seductive Interaction Design. And what this proposes is that there's often two ways in which we can approach designing, you know, systems or designing apps. The first is we can take very much a functional approach where we are focused on the tasks that our product provides. So this is the features, the functionality, and then we can kind of move up to there. So we'll start off with the functions in mind, making a useful application. The other approach we could take is more from the experience's point of view. So that is very much focusing first and foremost on the experience that the user will have. So, you know, that is looking at trying to make some kind of application which is meaningful, so has personal significance, pleasurable, convenient, and then kind of work our way down. There's no, you know, right or wrong way to approach this, but it's just, you know, providing a way to look at it from different perspectives. Because often as developers, we may start by looking at what functionality we can provide, but it may be interesting also to look at attacking it from the other perspective as well. And what's interesting is we can have a look at many different apps out there that kind of take this approach on experience first. One of my other favorite to-do list apps, so we'll go with the theme of to-do list apps, is Carrot To-Do. So who's seen Carrot before? Yeah, okay, Carrot. It's basically so you have an AI taskmaster who makes sure that you are doing your tasks. So you have Carrot, and basically you have, you know, this very much a to-do list app, but if you don't do your tasks, say, on time, or there's a period of time between you doing your tasks, so, you know, this character will get angry at you. So, you know, have mood swings, and then will punish you for doing so. Another great example of a to-do list app which is very much focused on the experience first is Epic Win. So if you have a look at this one, when you first look at this, you'd probably think, oh yeah, this looks like it's straight out of a video game, right? It looks like a quest list from a video game. When in actual fact, it is a to-do list. So you have your list of tasks over here, you have experience points applied to them, and then as you complete them, you have a character, and this character levels up and grows in things such as strength, stamina, intellect. You also collect loot as you go about undertaking your tasks as well. And travel down this particular path. So these apps very much focus on the user experience, or and focus on creating a unique user experience for the users. So when we talk about user experience, if you want to create a product that stands out, you have to think beyond basic functionality, beyond usability, and beyond convenience. So you have to explore what kind of experience you want the user to have when they're using your app, but also without forgetting the basics of usability as well. So user experience itself encompasses all aspects of the end user's interaction with the company, its services, and its products. So it's not just focusing on the usability goals, it encompasses everything with the app itself. So we looked at these before. These are the usability goals. These are proposed by Priest, Sharp, and Rogers. And if we zoom out, we can see that they are encompassed within other user experience goals as well. So user experience encompasses more than just these usability goals. It takes into account the entire experience that a user has with our application. And UX goals may include making your software, for example, fun to use, emotionally fulfilling, rewarding, motivating, helpful, entertaining, etc. So let's have a quick look at some great examples of applications out there that really focus on fulfilling these user experience goals. So a lot of these examples are from the website Little Big Details, which is a great resource for looking at apps which have created something unique. Okay, so fun. An example of a software which has focused really on fun is if you've ever opened up Chrome and tried to connect to the internet before, you'll probably get something which looks a bit like this. However, if you press spacebar, it actually turns into a game. Yeah, you'll have to try it out. Maybe not wait till the end of this presentation. But if you press spacebar, it's kind of a hidden Easter egg. But what's interesting is that, it takes a moment which could be very frustrating for the user. So, when you can't have access to the internet, and it turns it into more of a fun experience to kind of alleviate that pain that you may feel without, having connection to the internet, I guess. So this may be able to help change your mood in a fun way. Epic Win, again, we talked about it earlier. It's a great example of using fun that you may find in games to apply it to something which may be a little bit more tedious, such as a to-do list. In terms of emotionally fulfilling, Clear App. So marking off tasks in succession plays those musical notes up in a scale as well, which can be quite emotionally fulfilling to hear that scale kind of move up and then pull down and hear the sound effect for clearing all of your tasks. In terms of rewarding, Tim talked about Swarm yesterday. Incredibly rewarding in terms of things like the coins you get and just the visual animation and the experience that is accompanied with checking into particular locations. Again, rewarding can be seen in the form of Easter eggs. So if you jump onto the Kickstarter webpage, there's a little scissors icon down the bottom of the Kickstarter page. And if you tap it three times, the scissors go across the screen, the bottom falls away, and you find a secret. So there's kind of these rewarding experiences which have been built into apps as well. Another one of my favorites, is on the Vogue UK website. If you enter the Konami code, up, up, down, down, left, right, what is A, B, A, B, start, select, velociraptors randomly appear with hats on them. It doesn't really relate to the experience of the Vogue website. It's more a hidden Easter egg, but nonetheless is quite rewarding for the user when they find these Easter eggs and they can share them with their friends. Supportive of creativity is another important user experience goal, and I think Canva does this quite well in the tutorial that they provide, which is built into the editor. So what's quite nice about this particular tutorial is that, it's built into the editor, so it's not something which you're just kind of swiping through, which a lot of users will kind of ignore generally when it comes to your app. So it teaches you the editor, but it also supports for creativity in the sense that you can choose kind of what you do. So for example, at this particular step, it asks you to search for a hat and put it on this monkey. So you can search for whatever hat you want, and then you can choose to put that whatever hat you want onto the monkey itself. So it supports this creativity. Aesthetically pleasing, another user experience goal. So this is a great example. The Android browser for this particular example changes color depending on the sock color that you choose while you're shopping. So it's quite aesthetically pleasing. Another great one is from Yahoo Weather. So as the temperature goes down, the screen corners frost over the colder the temperature. So it's hard to see, but if we zoom in, you can actually see in this particular app, it starts to frost over. And we see this, I think, in also the weather app on the iPhone as well, is that often we'll see rain played in the background, or there'll be some, kind of experience added to make it more interesting. Now, in terms of motivation, Duolingo is a great example of an application that uses motivational elements in order to turn basically learning a language into something that's more fun. If we look at helpful, a great example is an Evernote, which automatically converts the date format dependent on the column width. So, you know, they're really focused on creating a more helpful experience, whereas, you know, just pulling it out and pulling it in may usually for an app just, you know, kind of, they might put ellipses there. It may not be that useful, but this one you can see it actually changes it to make it more useful. And this one's great. I like this. It's a little character that points to something when you've done something wrong and has this expression on his face. He's like, what have you done? You know, this is wrong. So it kind of draws attention to it, and it's quite helpful. Entertaining. There's great examples out there which focus on creating an entertaining experience, just building it into the app. One of my favorite would have to be in Google Maps. If you grab the little character for Street View and you drag him around, he actually gets, you know, kind of dragged around as if you were actually holding him and holding him above before you drop him down. So this is Pegman. When you're dragging him around, you hold his hand and you actually, you know, it has some kind of physics applied to it. It looks like he's being kind of dragged around. And then also enjoyable. So Snapchat, a great example. When you scroll down in Snapchat, there's these couple of ghosts, and if you scroll down far enough, they start playing a game of soccer. And I think this was an example that Steph used yesterday in her presentation in terms of satisfaction. So I send out a campaign, I guess, a newsletter on gamification, and this is actually... I think you were saying that it creates a sense of fun. This is actually really stressful for me. So I see this monkey, he's sweating, I'm like, oh, maybe I need to go back and just check my newsletter just to make sure it's okay and I haven't got too many spelling mistakes. So I think it's quite satisfying then, though, of course, when you actually send the campaign and he gives you a high five. So this is character in MailChimp. It's a newsletter sending software, and you know, it has this, it's embedded, this character, throughout the actual interface. Okay, so those are some examples of apps which are, you know, kind of focused on these user experience goals or encapsulate these user experience goals within their design. Why do we need to consider this? So, you know, we want to create a memorable experience for users, and by focusing on these user experience goals and designing for some of these or many of these, we can create a more memorable experience for our users. And this is what we want to do. We want to create kind of an app which is seductive, one that creates a memorable experience rather than something that is just usable. And addressing these goals goes beyond just making something that is usable. So it can influence our users as well. And what's interesting is that if we focus on, you know, designing for one of these particular user experience goals or more, you know, it goes beyond just making something which is pretty or something which is nice. So if we look at aesthetically pleasing, for example, aesthetics is really important when we're designing our apps. So obviously we want to make our app look beautiful, but there are certain psychological reasons for doing this as well. So different aesthetic choices that we have, that we make for our app have the ability to influence a number of things that our users experience. So there's first of all cognition, affect, and associations. So if we look at cognition, this is the process of knowing. So based on patterns and experiences, we learn how to understand the world around us. So, for example, you know, what do certain colors suggest? What does a particular shape suggest? And aesthetics plays a critical role in cognitive processing as well. So if something's not easy to understand how to use, it's going to take longer for us to try and work out how to do it. So this example, this is an example from two different chess apps. So we have a chess app on the left here, which doesn't really follow, you know, it's much more difficult to understand kind of what is interactive here, what UI elements line up to particular parts of it. So for example, the login username and password is quite obvious, but then this particular element here, you know, does that align to save password? Probably. These buttons don't really look like buttons as well. But if we compare it to the chess.com app on the right-hand side, we can see clearly that, you know, that login button is a button. And so by considering, you know, the aesthetics of the designs that we create, we can design to make our apps more effective by making them look like things that they should, I guess. So I don't know. This goes back to that guideline. You know, this doesn't really look like a button. You know, if we compare this to buttons in real life, this, you know, compared to the login button, It looks more like a button. If we look at the visual design as well, what's interesting is if we delve down into kind of the psychology behind it, different aesthetic choices have the potential to influence feelings and emotions of users as well, which can in turn influence perceived and actual usability of our designs. So there's been work that's done that looks at if something's more attractive, people will consider it easier to use, even if it may not actually be easier to use. In addition to that, if something's more attractive, it's generally seen as more credible as well, more trustworthy. And so maybe this is another example here, but you can see that the design here potentially looks a little bit more trustworthy, a little bit more credible than, say, this design over here, just because of some of the aesthetic choices. Okay, so this is all very useful, but where do you actually start? So I want to finish up by talking about some methods, some tools, and some tips. So we saw the user experience hierarchy of needs, and this is a great starting point to start thinking about designing from your user's perspective and the experience that you want to create for your user. So do you want to create a fun experience for them? Do you want to create something which is going to punish them for not doing their tasks on time? And then you could probably think about the functionality underneath it as well. And also another great approach is picking a particular user experience goal and using that as a starting point. Maybe for an app that you are currently designing or for an app that you currently have on the App Store. You know, can you ask yourself, is my app emotionally fulfilling? Is my app supportive of creativity? If not, how could I add these elements to my app to make it a better user experience? Probably one of the most useful frameworks I've found for considering experience design in your apps that you create is one proposed by Donald Norman in his book Emotional Design. So he provides a useful framework in terms of thinking about emotional design, and he proposes that there are three ways which good design makes you happy. And it can make you happy viscerally, behaviorally, or reflectively. And so let's look at the first one, viscerally. So what he means by this is that this is all about your initial emotional response to a design. So as soon as you open up the application, what is your initial emotional response? Are you looking at it? Is it attractive? Does it smell? Well, maybe not with apps, yeah, because we haven't got the ability to smell them yet. Does it smell good? Does it feel good? Physical features really dominate at this particular level. So when designing a product, you should consider the look, the feel, and the sound of the product, and consider what emotional response you are going for. What would appeal to your target user? And aesthetics, in this sense, it includes everything that appeals to the senses. So see, hear, smell, taste, and feel. In the digital realm, when you're creating your apps, this includes visual design, motion, sound, and even haptic responses. And it's important to consider how do aesthetic design choices influence understanding and emotions, and how do understanding and emotions influence behavior of the users. So if we look at the visceral design of the app Clear, so let's go back to this because it's a great example. Very vibrant colors. It's got a great layout in terms of the space that's used. And it also makes great use of sound effects. So as we saw in the video, the sound, which provides feedback as you mark off tasks. And also, it provides haptic feedback as well. So as you mark off a task, it vibrates the phone. So it kind of reinforces the importance of, or the delight, I guess, of actually marking off tasks as you do them. The second way in which Don Norman proposes design makes you happy is behaviorally. So when he talks about this, this is the functional response to a product. So what does the product actually do? Does it perform the function that it's supposed to? And when designing for this level, this is where it's important to consider utility and usability of a design. And enhancements to a product in this stage primarily come from watching how people use it. What's interesting is that if we look at the Clear app, so we discussed some of the review titles before for the app. So, we can see that people really liked it. But I did miss out a couple of other titles which were there as well. So these are some other ones from more negative reviews of the application. So we have, innovative but useless. Needs more functionality. Pretty but pointless. Meh. So what's interesting is they've kind of traded in certain functionality in order to create a certain experience. It doesn't have maybe all the functions that a traditional to-do list app would have, but they've made the active choice to do this. And when you do this, you're not going to appeal to everyone because you're creating a particular design which is targeted at users. But nonetheless, with their design, they still have a very good average rating. So out of 7,010 ratings, they still have a 4-star rating, which is pretty good. So it's just looking at the trade-in that of functionality for a particular experience. Needless to say, they are adding more features and supporting gestures as well for a sense of mastery, which is interesting to see. So, you know, compared to do list tasks, this has a lot of support for gestures in there as well, which, you know, makes it easy for, I guess, or makes it interesting for people to try and master the design or using it. Finally, Don Norman proposes that good design can make you happy on a reflective level as well. And so what he means by this is that this final way is much deeper, a deeper emotional response to things. And this is reflection. And this is when the user asks, what is the value of this product? What does it mean to me? How does it fit within my own personal image? And this can actually be really hard to design for. So designing for reflection is much harder to do than the other two, you know, viscerally or behaviorally. It's about the message that the app has, it's about the culture that it fits into, and it's also about the meaning of a product. Quality and brand is important, and you need to consider how the design empowers the user. Probably one of the most important things is to ask at this point is, if you're trying to design for something which is going to be reflective, is how does this particular app fit within a person's values, and how does it make the person proud to share it? So with the Clear app, they do this, I guess, it's harder to kind of pull this apart and look at how it supports reflection. But I guess one way that they, you know, do this is that they provide inspirational quotes, which may appeal to certain people. So, you know, we have one from, you know, when you clear your entire list, it then pops up with a particular quote. So we can see one from Yoda. One from Ben Franklin and Leonardo da Vinci, and you can share this with other people. So, you know, they've built in mechanisms to share these quotes, which may be inspiring for the particular person using the application. In addition to that, you know, I find it quite fun to share this app because of the sound effects that it has. So the way that, you know, you tick things off. And I find myself walking around when I'm shopping, ticking them off, just seeing if anyone kind of has a response to, you know, what's going on. It's quite interesting. It fits within some people's images as well. Okay, right, so that, we've covered a lot. But a couple of starting points to consider. So, you know, we've looked at a lot of examples. We've looked at some of the frameworks behind creating emotional design. Where are some places you can start as a designer, as a developer? Customization is quite easy to integrate, and it can provide the ability for users to customize the way that your app looks for them, and you know they can personalize it to you know what they like. I guess Clear has an example of this in the way that they provide different themes for the application. So you can different themes with different colors, and you can customize it. Easter eggs are always fun to include in your application because once someone finds it, they always want to share it. Then. If it's a fun Easter egg. So, you know, with the Snapchat one or the example of the velociraptors with hats on them, as soon as someone finds that, you know, it creates a great way for them to kind of share your app with others out there. Sound effects are quite easy to add into your app and can be great in terms of a form of feedback. And if you get the chance, you could even consider characters. So, for example, like the Carrot app has this, you know, moody character, which ties into the app experience. If you look at MailChimp, they have a this monkey character, which ties into the experience as well. And also animations can be quite easy to add into your app as well. And Tim talked about this yesterday in his presentation. If all else fails, just add in ridiculous animations, and you know, hopefully that will wow your users. Okay, great. I think, yeah, look at that. We have 3 more minutes left. But basically, that covers looking at usability, looking beyond usability, at user experience goals, and some examples and ways you can get started. We did well. That usually fits into a 2-hour lecture for my students, and we managed to smash that out in 45 minutes. So we've got 3 minutes to take questions if anyone has it. But just before I do, I want to suggest 3 books. The first one is Don't Make Me Think, by Steve Krug. The second one is Emotional Design by Donald Norman. And the third one is Seductive Interaction Design. So the one thing I want you to take away is mainly to look beyond usability. So we should all be creating usable apps, but to start thinking about ways in which we can create more memorable experiences by focusing on the user experience goals that we want to support and create for our users. Excellent. Yeah, questions?
In terms of Easter eggs, right?
Yeah.
So you have Konami code on the Vogue website.
Yes.
So you wouldn't really associate fashion with Konami.
Mm.
And vice versa and stuff like that. So how do you sort of get this Easter egg out? Because the Konami code on anything is pretty hard to know, unless you're like a game adorer.
Yeah.
So do you have to sort of leak it to one person and hopefully that one person's but aren't we just going to...
It's a good question.
Put a balloon in the sky and let it...
I think you can do it either way. I think as soon as you leak it, though, it's going to be... Well, it depends. So it can work as a marketing tool, which is great. Or it's just fun to include things and see if they find them as well as a developer, right? So...
We've got, like, Easter eggs that live in games for, like, over a decade.
Oh, yeah.
They don't get discovered.
It depends on what your goals are, I guess, for the Easter egg. If you want to use it as a marketing tool, you know, in a way to create something funny that creates a funny emotional response from people once they find it, and then so something that they can share with others, then you may probably want to leak it to one person or two people. But if you want to create something which people, you know... You just want to see how long it takes for them to find it, right? And you could just put it in there and just not tell anyone. I guess it's a little easier with websites because you can kind of go through the source code, at least, and see if there's any hints there. So you can place hints, I guess. It becomes like a game. But yeah, it really depends on what the purpose for adding the Easter egg is in the first place. Yeah?
If you're doing client-based work, there's obviously a cost for the time that you spend.
Mm.
Do you have an elevator pitch or something similar where you can use to try and describe the value of putting in something like an Easter egg to a client who might not really understand.
Oh, that's a good point. I don't know how you'd pitch that. I mean, so these days, you know, it's all about career. Yeah, I wonder. How would you pitch that to a client? Who has any ideas? Has anyone pitched anything like that, an Easter egg to a client at all?
People like to go viral, so if you say it.
Yeah. So I guess if you can tie it back to the business goals somehow. So when you're looking at designing apps, particularly for clients, you often have the business goals, which you're trying to design for, but you also have the user goals as well. And if you can marry those two somehow together, that could be a way you could pitch it. So yeah, for example, you know, it will create a better user experience, and then maybe that links back to virality, for example, in the app itself. So maybe... I wouldn't suggest that. You could do it without telling them potentially, but I don't. You know, once they find it, maybe they may not be that pleased. But it's okay. You've been paid by then, so it's okay, right? Excellent. That's a lot to cover. If you have any other questions, we've got morning tea now, so come up to me, talk to me. If you want to talk about gamification, feel free to come up and chat to me. Otherwise, thank you for coming along, and we'll see you around.